After an incredibly busy week in our nation's capital and for the country, I sat down for an exclusive interview with President Trump. The conversation covering everything from his upcoming Supreme Court pick to the debate over tariffs and phase two of his plan for the economy. Take a listen. Mr. President, thanks so much for sitting down with me.
Well, thank you very much.
I want to start right with the breaking news of the week, and that is Justice Anthony Kennedy announcing his retirement. Is Justice Kennedy the model of the person you would put on the Supreme Court now?
Maybe so. He's a great gentleman. He's a very high quality person. You know, I got a call, Maria, that somebody would like to see me. And they were sort of like acting anonymous. I said, wait a minute, I'm the president of the United States. How could I see somebody? I don't know who it is. Anyway, I figured it out. And it was a very elegant moment. It was a beautiful moment. He presented me with a letter. And it really is a retirement of a great gentleman. He's a fine, fine gentleman, and really did. Ended up being a little more neutral than a lot of people would have preferred, but a lot of people preferred that he was. And we're going to pick somebody who's outstanding. And I said, I'll do it in your honor, but we're going to pick somebody who's outstanding. And I was very honored that he did this during my term, which means he had confidence in me to do the right thing.
Are you going to ask your nominees beforehand how they might vote on Roe versus Wade?
Well, that's a big one, and probably not. They're all saying, don't do that, you don't do that, you shouldn't do that. But I'm putting conservative people on, and I'm very proud of Neil Gorsuch. He has been outstanding. His opinions are, you know, is so well written, so brilliant. And I'm going to try and do something like that, but I don't think I'm going to be so specific in the questions I'll be answering. And I'm actually told that I shouldn't be.
Because on the campaign trail, you said you would leave it to the states.
Well, maybe someday it will be to the states. You never know how that's going to turn out. That's a very complex question. The Roe v. Wade is probably the one that people are talking about in terms of having an effect. But we'll see what happens. But it could very well end up with states at some point.
And do you think you'll be able to get your nominee in place before the midterm elections?
I think it's going to go very quickly. I think we're going to have a lot of support. I think we're going to have support from Democrats, frankly. I think if it's the right person, I'm going to pick the right person. I'm going to pick somebody that's outstanding. And everybody on that list is outstanding, but I'm going to pick somebody who's outstanding. And I think, yes, I think we will go very quickly. I actually believe that. A lot of people think it's going to be a very... Look, it's probably going to be vicious because the other side, all they can do is obstruct and resist. You know, the whole thing is resist. But, and maybe someday we'll be able to get along with the other side. I don't know. But right now it's only resist. That's all they want to do is stop things from happening. So they're going to try very hard. But I think it's going to go actually very quickly if I pick the right person.
Mr. President, here we are 6 months after you signed into law a historic tax reform package. First time in 30 years. Has the effect been what you expected?
Well, I think there's a double effect. The tax cuts have been incredible, and reform, don't forget, but tax cuts have been incredible.
And the rollback in regulations.
But I think the big thing, I actually think maybe at least initially speaking, because it's been earlier, took place quicker, the regulation rollback has been the biggest ever in the history of our country. No president, even during full terms, has cut back anywhere near what I've done. And we have more to do. Now, we're going to have regulation. We're going to have clean water. We're going to have, you know, clean air. We're going to have the cleanest water, cleanest air. But we are we have more regulation cutting to do. But so, I think that may have had a bigger impact to this point. I think ultimately the tax cuts, as they kick in, and they're kicking in, you see the kind of hundreds of billions of dollars brought back into the country already. I think ultimately that's going to be something really special, and you're seeing the result right now.
I agree with you, because under President Obama, the Federal Registry pages were up to 97,000 pages or something like
that. Honestly, if the Democrats would have won the election, first of all, you would have had a lot different. If you look at the last four decisions in the Supreme Court at 5-4, they would have all been reversed. The union decision was a massive decision. The you can look at any one of those four. They were all so big, so important, and they would have been exactly reversed. So many. That's why I've always heard that as president, I mean, obviously outside of war and peace, the biggest decision you can make is the selection of a Supreme Court justice. And I see it. And you see it so vividly over the last 2 days because, I mean, those decisions would have all gone the other way.
And your legacy on the conservative party on the GOP is going to be massive, obviously, with this very consequential decision making that you need to do. Let me ask you about what's next, because we've seen the impact to the economy. What do you want to see happen now? Does the economy need even more stimulus? Are you looking for phase two tax
plan? We're doing a phase two. We'll be doing it probably in October, maybe a little sooner than that. And it'll be more of a middle class. We did a lot for the middle class, but this will be even more aimed at the middle class. One of the things we're thinking about is bringing the 21% down to 20. And then for the most part, the rest of it would go right to the middle class. It's a great stimulus. And one of the things I'm doing that you've been reporting on, although I'm not sure that you're a believer, but I think you're getting there. Look what's happening with the steel companies. They're expanding. They're going wild. And we need steel and we need aluminum. And we need solar panels. And, you know, the same thing with solar panels. It was like a dead business. And we did a 30% tariff because they were dumping all over the place. And washing machines doesn't sound very glamorous. It's actually a very big business. But if you look at what's happened to steel and aluminum, we practically built a new industry in a period of 4 or 5 months. It's incredible what's happening. But the big thing that I'm focused on now is trade. I have to straighten out trade deals. Maria, we have trade deals, as an example, with China. We don't even have a trade deal with China. We don't have a deal. Nobody bothered to make a deal. And they'll charge 25% for a car, and we charge 2.5%, and you've used those numbers on your show, so I don't want to bore people. But we have the worst trade deals in the world. We lose money with everybody. You know, when somebody walks in and says, how much do we lose with this country? We lose with everybody. We're going to make it reciprocal. We're going to make them fair. And I will tell you that you don't know about this, but every country is calling every day saying, let's make a deal, let's make a deal. It's going to all work out.
And the markets feel like they're trusting you at this point.
I think they trust me, and the farmers trust me.
They do.
Don't forget, the farmers, and I want all the farmers. I want that whole, you look at a map, it's got a little blue on the outside. Everything else is red, and it's beautiful color red. But I have to say that if you look at what's happened with farms, over 15 years, it's just a steady decline. Over the last I've been here a year and a half. Over the last 5 years, they've been very bad years for farms and farmers. I said, we have to change that. And one of the reasons is because they have barriers. These aren't even economic barriers, although in Canada's case, 275% tariff for dairy. That's not fair.
So when would you expect your most significant deal?
Well, I already pretty much finished the deal with South Korea. It was a terrible deal. Remember, it was going to produce 200,000 jobs, and they were right. For South Korea, not for us. That was a Hillary Clinton special. That's done. NAFTA, I could start it tomorrow, but I'm not happy with it. I want to make it more fair. Okay,
You can't do NAFTA before the midterms.
I want to wait till after the election. You're going to have an election. It's going to be very interesting. I have a feeling he's going to be fine. And the reason is because if they're not fine, I'm going to tax their cars coming into America. And that's the big one. You know, the cars are the big one. We could talk steel. We could talk everything. The big thing is the cars.
A major lobbying group for the auto industry says that your administration has threatened 25% tariff on all imported vehicles will amount to $45 billion in taxes on consumers and wipe out any benefits of the tax cut plan for low and middle income Americans.
Well, actually, it's 20%. Tell them to get their numbers right. Look, what's going to really happen? There's going to be no tax. You know why? They're going to build their cars in America. They're going to make them here. We bring in millions and millions of cars a year. We charge 2.5%. Some of these countries don't even take our cars. If we want to send General Motors or any of our companies to some of these countries, they won't take our cars. They have a barrier. They put up a barrier, non-monetary barrier. They call it non-monetary tariff. And the barrier is so strong, you can't sell a car. If you do sell a car, it's 10%, 15%, 25%. And we get 2.5% and nobody pays it.
Yeah. But do you agree, though, that a tariff is a sales tax? I mean, even Steve Forbes was on my show last week. He said, look, for every job you're creating in the aluminum and steel industry, you're losing 15 in the industries that import aluminum and steel. Is it a sales tax?
First of all, I love free trade. You know, when I was at the G7, I said, I have an idea. Everybody, I'll guarantee you, we'll do it immediately. Nobody pay any more tax. Everybody take down your barriers. No barriers, no tax. Everybody, are you all set? No more tax. Canada, you're not going to get 275% for your dairy, and you're going to take down all your barriers. We're going to take down all our barriers. We're going to take down all our taxes, right? You know what happened? Everybody said, can we get onto another subject? Because America, our country, lost last year $817 billion in terms of deficit. We had a trade deficit, Maria, of $817 billion, with a B, dollars last year. Before that, it was 800. This has been going on for years. We have rebuilt China. I have a great relationship with China, great relationship with President Xi. I have tremendous respect for him. But I said, we have to straighten this out. We can't continue to do this.
Well, you decided to not go forward with the investment restrictions on China.
No, no.
Are you going back down on the tariffs against China?
No. And look, we're in for, you know, we put in $250 billion worth of product. The tariffs are, in fact, it could go up to 500, frankly, if we don't make a deal. And they want to make a deal. I will tell you, China wants to make a deal. And so do I, but it's got to be a fair deal for this country. One of the hard things is our presidents and our business leaders, they were missing in action. Not so much the business leaders. You know, some business leaders benefit by allowing this stuff to go on. That's the problem. They benefit. They're more for their business than they are for the United States. I had a great company, the head of a great company, come up to me. He's very seriously affected by the tariffs. He said, Mr. President, it's not good for me right now. Ultimately, it is. But you're doing the right thing on tariffs.
Well, you're doing the right thing on pushing back on China as well. Most people understand that they've been stealing from us for decades.
Right.
But you didn't go forward with this ban on Chinese nationals acquiring a 25% stake in American companies that are in this China 2025. Yeah. But now people want to know, how are you going to protect American innovation, technology, the crown jewels?
So we're doing it through CFIUS, we're doing it through different things. But what I didn't like is pinpointing China, because it's not fair. I get along with China. I like the president. He's president for life. We can call him the king, right? But I like the president. I didn't like pinpointing China. I don't think it's fair, because they're not the only ones. Now, they're bigger and stronger, and frankly, they do it more, and they're probably a bigger violator. But it's other countries, too. And I want it to go worldwide. And we are doing that. So actually, what I'm doing is a very similar thing, but I want it to pertain to everybody. So you mean China can't do it, but other countries can. Now, I know China, and I know how smart they are. They'll send their people into other countries and do it through other countries. And they'll just go through an extra process.
That's why you had to do it on everybody, our friends.
I want everybody to do it. Same thing with the tariffs on the steel. If we don't have it on everybody, then what happens is they put it through these other countries that don't have it, and you're wasting a lot of time.